Electronic again, and I'm the maker of the NERDSEQ Eurorack sequencer with the tracker style user interface, as you can see on the screens. I will not explain how the NERDSEQ works, because that's already covered a lot of times and stuff. So I just show some new stuff, which is really interesting. Some missing point was already always the performance thing. And I think I built some new stuff which makes it very flexible to perform in new ways in different styles, plus some, yeah, it gives more I missed the word, however. It's a very simple, so I added a kind of a mapping screen, or it's called mapping screen. And it's in the simplest use, it's you map a source to a destination. And in my case, I have the fader box, which is connected via I2C at this moment, but it can be MIDI, it can be CV input, or it can be any parameter or thing within the sequencer, so it doesn't matter what the source is. And so with this here, I have the fader connected, and it changes the values. And for here, I have the drums, and I can use the fader to fill in the Euclidean sequence. So, another thing is, for example, if I go down here, I have like the same fader box, but then different different faders, and I use them to change notes in the sequence. So, if I go here, in this part, let's go there. I have now an empty sequence, and I can. So I changed with the eight faders, and it can be up to 64 actually, so you can have the whole sequence and you can connect four of these fader boxes. And you can change the sequence, the fader completely down would be no note, and the rest is there at some drums. And I enable some scaling. Go to pentatonic. And again the drums. So that's one new part, so very easy, and I will load another project in a second. So, and I have the same mapping again, and with this mapping I can also write off some code of code. So actually, if there's a function missing in the sequence or you want to do something special, you can just code it yourself in there. And if you can't code, it doesn't really matter, because you can import, export this stuff. And on the forum, if someone probably requests, hey, can someone do this and this? And then there would be probably someone who does this and this and can put it on the forum, and it will be a lot of stuff. So me, for myself, I implemented now two different functions. And one is a bouncing ball. So you know that. And I can just execute it. So, a simple bouncing ball, and in the mapping it's like the first lines up to there, and I have like a different counters running, and the counters going really faster with each bounce until it stops again. So, a simple algorithm which is running, and you can execute it from the sequence. You can involve it in the sequence somehow, that you can change the parameters and the variables. So we have also a set of variables that you can use within the coding. And another function I have someone ask me, hey, can you add a Turing machine in the thing? You know all the Turing machine? And I actually didn't, I knew it, but I didn't know exactly what it does. So I checked it up and I could completely implement it also in this coding part. And so that's what I did. Here on the right side, you see actually the sequence. I go in there and have like four faders connected. And one fader is to set the bits. One is to reset the bits. One will flip the bits. And one will do just a random thing. So when I use the fader, you see on the right like the Turing machine running. You can see it, yeah, slightly. So let's add some drums also here. And also add scaling here because it's because Turing machine is not really scaled normally, and then it sounds always better. So it can just generate sequences by itself, but and if I do the random thing, it will be always a different sequence. And I keep it like this, and it stays with it. So the Turing machine can work up to 12 bits, from 1 to 12 bits. And in the mapping code, it's a bit more complicated, actually, how it's implemented. So I have like a setup that it only works when the clock is running and things, and I connected it to the clock, so it's synchronized with the sequence. And here I have like a simple thing like the CV input, and this is used to set the bits, and then I have like different calculations and things, and this is like a bitwise OR, and I just add the bit with an OR function, logical function. And these are like, for example, these are they show the sequence on the trigger expander, just a simple thing, so it's visually also quite nice. It does also trigger these parts, so you could use it as well. So there's a lot more with that, and I think this can be a really big thing with the coding, because you could just do what you think, like, oh, this is cool, I want to do it, and it's probably possible. So and also the coding involves like if then things and everything you can imagine with arithmetic stuff. And And then you can use all parameters in the NerdSec to feed the coding, and you can execute it on every parameter. It doesn't matter what the CV outputs internally, the probability, or whatever. So, So I think that can be quite a nice thing. And then the most easy thing, use a fader box and change your parameters, or a MIDI box or whatever. So, that's really short what it is, and there will be soon. There will be the new firmware with the new expander for MIDI and I2C and things, and then it really makes sense to in the bigger view for the thing, and then there will be deeper explanations, and I will probably do some more patches to integrate there and to explain exactly what they do, because and I'm learning myself as well with that, so it's like learning a new programming language. Even I made it myself. You have to get used to it to get used to the kind of coding. But it can be also kind of live coding. So you just change stuff on the fly and get the effect there, or get the result that it doesn't work anymore. And but that's just like, what it is. So that's basically it for now. There's a lot more, but that's it. Okay.